get high. Let's get high. Come on, let's get high. Let's get high. All my ladies, let's get high.
Hey, this is Daniel Montero, Ganja Smoke Break. We're here at Cafe Flore SF. Thank you, Luke and Terrence. Thank you, Morris, SF Roots. And thank you, Aaron Flynn from Gold Seal SF. I'm here with Marisa.
That's right.
And your last name again?
Rodriguez.
Rodriguez, that's right. Marisa Rodriguez. I'm Daniel Montero, as we
nice
were talking,
to meet you.
Born and raised San Jose. And we're working on creating content for the cannabis industry, highlighting authentic cannabis culture. And part of it, since now you're involved,
right,
is to highlight professionals as yourself who don't necessarily, as you said, have a history with the plant, but yet are qualified to help regulate it. Before we start, normally I would light a joint, but of course, that's something that we're not going to do during this interview, right?
Okay.
Jumping right into things. I know you're born and raised in San Francisco, and do you have any memories of cannabis as a child? Did a relative maybe smoke it, or some friends that may have asked you to smoke it with them?
I think cannabis has been just prevalent and pervasive and part of community my entire life.
Okay.
I don't think I really have a memory where it's not necessarily been somewhat present.
Were those positive? Were those negative?
I've only had positive interactions.
And growing up, how would you describe cannabis culture?
Well, certainly probably more excitement around it when I was younger, you know. Probably middle school through high school. You know, I grew up in San Francisco. I grew up an inner city kid, a single parent mom, and it was, I think her biggest fear was always just kind of trying to keep me straight and narrow. She did a pretty good job,
yes,
ultimately.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't say that it wasn't something that was part of just kind of growing up in life. You know, it was present. And there wasn't anything wrong.
And you never tried cannabis?
I never tried cannabis.
Wow.
Yeah. And, you know, partly because I had a little bit of an asthma issue and some other sort of health issues that kind of kept me a little bit, you know, away from it. But I never had an issue as far as friends and kind of being around it. I never thought that there was concern.
Your mom maybe deserves a shout out.
Yeah, right on.
Being the pillar, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Uh-huh. And you know, and I lost my mom at a really young age. So it was in high school, my mom passed away. And I think that also just kind of her support, her legacy, all that she kind of worked for me as a young person, made me really focused on making sure that I got an education, that I continued through with school, and that I made sure not to deviate in any way. So I think that also kind of just kept me focused.
And you lived with your grandmother after that, or your father?
No, I was on my own. Both my parents passed away when I was really young. The only relative that was kind of related and connected was my grandfather, who is actually a grand uncle, who lives with me now. So he's in his late 80s.
Mm-hmm.
I've kept around. And then it was actually community and family friends that raised me. And those are the people I call family. So I have an adopted family in Marin that I went to high school with their children, and they knew that I was alone. And so they stepped up to the plate and made sure that they could be a resource to me and a family to me, and have supported me through my life. So I'm super fortunate. I think that I wouldn't necessarily be where I am today, but for their love and support as well. And other family members who were really just, you know, people that lived in our building, right? And people who were like, well, she's young and she's alone, so let's make sure we step up and be there for her. And so these are people who are family to me. That's what my family is. My father's side, they're from Texas, actually. And actually, both my parents came to San Francisco through the military, through the Presidio.
You're Latino?
Army. I am. Yeah, so my dad is Mexican, Mexican-American. And for him, it was either jail or the Army. So for him, he ended up in the Army, really smart guy, did really well in the Army. And they were stationed out here. My mom is actually an immigrant from Portugal. My mom was
That's
born in Portugal,
okay.
But my mom's father is Cape Verdean, and her mother is from the Azores. So I'm sort of this mix that only kind of happens when you have the military involved, right? And then I ended up in San Francisco because they came this way through the Presidio. Grew up in San Francisco, spent most of, because they came on the base, when my parents split, my mom decided to stay in San Francisco. She loved San Francisco. She loved the culture, she loved everything about it. She was like, I'm gonna stay here, I'm gonna raise my daughter here. And so she, the closest neighborhood to the kind of the base was the outer Richmond. and kind of a place where she could afford to find a place to raise me. So I grew up in the outer Richmond in San Francisco, went to school, all my school, all the way through high school in San Francisco, and then went to Berkeley for college. After college, moved to New York, was working for Court TV. I was kind of interested in journalism for a while, kind of like you. And so ended up at Court TV. Complete fluke, kind of an amazing story. One day we'll have time to talk about that. It was actually at Court TV where I realized, you know, law might be something, an avenue I'd be interested in. But knew that I didn't necessarily want to do it on the East Coast. I wanted to come back home. And so I was just going to apply to law school, come back home, and kind of take it from there. And then that's when I got into USF, decided to come back, moved back, went to law school. And it was actually in law school that I had the opportunity to intern at a district attorney's office. I had no interest in the criminal justice system in that way at that time. I think most people who knew me growing up would probably expect that I would have been a public defender. I think even some of the DAs I worked with probably would think I'd be a public defender.
So what led you that direction?
So actually, an opportunity came up and I thought, you know what, this could be interesting. So I got to work closely with one of the greatest mentors that I've had in my life, which was, he's an African-American man, DA, who was outstanding, super smart. He's on our bench now, he's a judge now. But at the time he was in homicide. And he's like, come on, just experience this. It's trial, you'll get some trial experience. So okay, so I joined him, it was a privilege. Got to be his intern, sat second chair on a homicide case. It was really interesting because I had a lot of emotion come up through that process.
I bet.
And you know, even the voir dire was a kind of an interesting thing. When we're picking the jury.
Is that what voir dire means?
Voir dire, yeah.
Picking jury.
It's a like
French
term. Yeah, uh-huh. Totally. And we kicked someone off the jury at the time and happened to be an African American man. But we had a basis for it. There was this kind of whole thing. And my boss at the time, my mentor, was like, he'd never kicked any African American person, no matter what. Even if we were prosecuting another family member, he was always like, I want a complete representation. And I want the defendant to have a fair case. But in this case, something came up and we were like, no, this is the right thing to do. And so essentially during a Batson-Wheeler motion, which is when the defense basically says, we have to make a showing that we're not kicking them on the basis of color or anything like that. I essentially got called racist on the record in sort of this kind of undertone, weird way where they were also trying to figure out like, what is your identity? And the defense attorney tried to describe me on the record for the court reporter. And I remember them stopping kind of like, what is she? What are they going to say? And of course, they didn't get it quite right. But I thought, wow, that's interesting. And I remember walking the halls of justice that day thinking, what am I doing? This is crazy, right?
Because
it was really loaded, right? And I didn't know that this was the right place for me, right?
What does loaded mean?
What does it mean?
In this context.
It's just heavy. You know, like...
Emotionally draining.
Emotionally, but just historically, that I would consider taking on this role in law enforcement. And I was kind of just going through the having all the feelings, right? And I'm walking through the halls of justice thinking all these things. And we get through the whole case, fast forward to the end of the case.
Which takes weeks, months.
It's months, actually. Mm-hmm. And we get to the end... And we had a verdict, and it's a guilty verdict, which is also heavy, right? And I remember, because this guy it was life, right? 25 to life. And I remember going up the elevator with the investigator, the lead investigator at the time. And he turns to me and says, Marisa, so what's it going to be, public defender's office or corporate law? And I was like, I just spent a whole semester with you. Like, did I stumble into some bad lighting? What's going on? And so I go back to talk to my boss, and I say, what's that about? And he says, you know, he can read people. He's been a homicide detective for 30 years. He's been watching you. And we've been talking about this.
Your heart's not in.
And not that. He said, in fact, he's like, you're really compassionate. He said that there's been a lot of moments here when you felt feeling. And he said, that's exactly why you should be a prosecutor. You should be at the table. Your voice should be here. So I said, you know what? I think you're right. And I knew that it was going to be a challenge the first few years of my career because I wouldn't have the discretion to make decisions the way that I thought it should be made. But I got to a point in my career where I was in policy and I got to shape sort of how we were going to move forward with things. I was on a great, great team. And the DA was really, really open and let me sort of take that lead. So I started programs at San Quentin, did a lot of work around criminal justice reform, but really prison reform too, and talking to the men inside. In fact, I'm taking the guys for my new job in to talk about the impact of the war on drugs, right? And you talked about equity a little bit and what that actually means. And I think you really need to know what it looks like to really be a part of really changing something, or making it better, so to speak. And you have to change it, but make it better, right? So that's sort of my journey.
To pause you really quickly.
Yeah.
So you're creating policy that started as being a prosecutor now.
Yeah.
But it sounds like that didn't, excuse me, quite resonate with you.
No, it didn't not resonate. It resonated. It took time getting comfortable with that idea. I think that's probably the fair way to say it.
And if I may, from that experience, what kind of policy were you putting your hands on, and how did that lead to cannabis?
So interestingly, it sort of didn't. You know, I think I was in this space where, you know, I was outward facing. So I was the director of community relations. And so a lot of the work that I was doing was being out in the community and engaging with the community and getting a sense of what was important to the community as it related to the criminal justice system, and coming up with ideas for how we could better do the work that we were doing from the inside. So not only was it work with community members here in San Francisco, but also, for example, with the program I started in San Quentin. It was a co-created program with the then editor-in-chief of the San Quentin News, and my father, who is my adopted father from Marin, right, who raised me, like after my mother passed away, who was a newspaper man, and one of his personal passion projects was work with the men inside and help them write newspaper. So he asked me to come in. And so all of these things just start to converge, right? Like you get these opportunities, you don't necessarily seek them, but they kind of find you. And I think that's what sort of happened here. I think, you know, my predecessor in this role did an amazing job setting up the Office of Cannabis. It wasn't necessarily on my radar. I was kind of focused on other things. Mind you, at the same time, our office was the first office to retroactively expunge marijuana convictions after Prop 64, right? So we're always trying to be in that space. Just being on the right side of history, I think, and on the right side of this thing called the criminal justice system, right? So I'm in this work, I'm doing this work, and then the opportunity sort of came to me. And I had to kind of think about it. Like, wait, what?
Eugene came to you?
No, So the Office of Cannabis is under our city administrator, and so it was the city administrator that came to me to talk to me about it.
What was your initial reaction?
I was first I said, I was like, oh, wait, did you mean to talk to me? She's like, yeah, and I go, you know I'm a prosecutor, right? She's like, yeah, I do. And so I sat with it, kind of started thinking about it. I was like, let me go home, I'm going to talk to my husband. He'll get a good laugh. I was like, hey, babe, what do you think of this? And he was like, hell yeah, that's amazing. I can't believe that gets to be your job. I was like, well, it's not yet. You know, I'm kind of thinking about it.
You're seeing free samples.
You're right. So he was just like, so it's so funny. So I end up taking it. And then he makes a joke. He's like, you know, you've been at this for like a month and a half now. Where are the samples? And I was like, I don't accept samples. He's like, what? What about me? So that's kind of, that's where that came from.
Well, we can definitely drop off a little sample for your husband.
I'm sure he'd appreciate that.
Now, this was about around the beginning of April you made this transition.
Yeah.
And I'm sure my wife, as an example, she is jumping into a new position, and she's not even getting paid yet at the beginning. She starts like at the beginning of July.
Okay.
But she's already getting emails.
Oh, yeah.
And she's like jumping right in. So in my imagination right now, you step into your new office, and I have a feeling like you're being bombarded.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yeah, it's correct. Yeah. You know, I was coming from an environment that was very fast-paced, and so I was kind of used to that, like, craziness and sort of the hornet's nest that was like criminal justice, and I think it has felt like a very natural process. I feel that it's a lot, and I know that there's a lot of different feelings. Like, you know, there's some people that really want cannabis in San Francisco to look one way, and there's other people that really want it to look another way. There's some sort of middle ground, and it's fine. I love it.
When you reflect on the 100 years of prohibition, I mean, literally, about 100 years more or less of Canada's prohibition, in your mind, what do we need to do today to help mend that prejudicial thinking, those stereotypes, this approach, you know, law-wise, regulatory-wise?
Yeah, you know, I think it's really interesting. Being a former prosecutor, I think that's a really unique thing to ask, because I was part of furthering that, right, so to speak.
Like Kamala Harris?
What do you mean?
And that she was a prosecutor, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
And she has taken a pro-cannabis stance.
Yes, Yeah. So, but I mean, as far as having been in a situation, I have prosecuted drug cases, right? And so what's interesting is kind of getting to this point and saying, we got this wrong. That was wrong. That's not how we should be looking at cannabis, right? It should not be a Schedule I drug. We got that wrong. And so for a number of reasons, you know, being a woman of color, being Mexican American, right? Historically, just kind of the racism that has been embedded in all of this around, you know, drug policy around cannabis. It hits personally also. And so for me, it's really important that we take this opportunity, and it's an amazing one, and I feel really privileged and honored to even be asked to do this work, to get it right. Like, let's get this right. Let's do whatever we can.
What does that mean?
It means, first of all, recognizing and acknowledging the fact that we got it wrong to begin with. And that in itself is going to take a huge lift. And I think that you're going to see that when you're starting your program in San Jose, and there are a lot of people who have been sort of entrenched in either politics or in law enforcement or other aspects that you need to partner with you to make this happen, to get this right. And you're going to need to switch and change minds. These are pathways, you know? People have risked their lives on both ends trying to further what sort of, you know, the government decided should be the rules around this. And it's really hard to back that up. And so right now, that's what we're really trying to do. Let's back that up and make this work for equity.
For equity, and we were talking about how there's a disconnect between the traditional consumers in general in California, and the regulated market. How California sold less legal weed in 2018 than in 2017. And so the language that I've been using in San Jose, it seems to catch everybody's attention, is how we can maximize long-term economic benefit by uniting our industry, by understanding that there's many ancillary businesses that stand to benefit as well. And we will be the number one place around the world for cannabis tourism. And if I'm not mistaken, San Francisco enjoys more revenues from tourism than they do from tech. And so if, as an example, Caliva is making X amount of millions of dollars, Caliva being a leading dispensary in San Jose today, with social consumption around the corner and what we were doing today with some music and maybe dancing and art and all the social experiences that alcohol is a part of, eventually cannabis will be as well. And so it boils down to like the zoning as we expand cannabis retail. It should be inclusive with social consumption in mind and how we can maximize long-term economic benefit and help to position San Jose to be a leading city in California by helping our leaders, business leaders and political leaders understand that by working together, we can really create a situation where cannabis benefits our greater community. And equity is this mechanism that allows us to create a more inclusive and diverse industry. And it's something that we also didn't get it right from the beginning. But nonetheless, I have to give credit to the courageous young men and women who were the first through the door, like Supernova Women, and, mm-hmm. Parks.
Yeah.
And of course, if you're the first one through the door, you're the first one catching a bullet, you're the first one in harm's way, you're the first one to have to get it right.
That's true.
And this is an industry where they're calling it an extinction event for many operators, and I'm sure you've heard maybe horror stories or the incredible level of difficulty that heritage operators, traditional, smaller operators have had in entering the legal market. And it's no easy responsibility on your shoulders. And so now moving forward from April until what's almost the end of May, have you learned anything about cannabis culture that you didn't before, or a certain appreciation about the community that you're now having to work with?
Absolutely. I think for me, we're here tonight with the community. They invited me to come out and celebrate with them and had kind of just welcomed me in a way that I made a joke that, you know, when I was a prosecutor, no one threw a party, right? It's a warm, welcoming, good vibes community.
Does it feel genuine?
People. It feels absolutely, it feels like SF. It feels like home. It feels like this feels really good. All the points that you were making, you know, I was kind of thinking of all of these different things. I've been asked a number of times, a number of different ways, and different, you know, journalists and other people coming to me saying, like, what are your four priorities? What are your priorities? What do you think? And honestly, like, sure, I have ideas of what I think would be helpful, and especially as I get up to speed. But I can't make I can't put out my priorities until I've heard from everybody, especially the individuals that you talked about just now. Those people who have been in the space, who have been first out, you know, to like get it right, like you said. Sitting down with them and hearing their stories and hearing what the challenges have been and hearing what sort of needs to happen from their perspective. There are a lot of people in this space and a lot of people shaping it. And to me, San Francisco's cannabis experience is going to be shaped by the people. And that's it.
You're absolutely right. What I've been saying is that the future of California cannabis tourism, what's going to magnetize the world to us, is how somebody from within the culture articulates the authentic cannabis experience. Just like, if are you into some sports or any hobbies maybe?
Dance?
So you can totally tell, easy example, right? If somebody's feeling the music or they're not, you know?
Yeah.
And if you're into dancing culture, I'm sure you'd be magnetized or attracted to other men and women who have the same deep, passionate appreciation for dance. I mean, when I think about dance right now, it can be such a passionate thing and evokes emotion. And
totally.
Cannabis is totally that, where those of us who are involved and have been involved at the root of it all have a love for the plant.
Yeah.
And I guess to address what we're talking about, I think those of us, or anybody who gets it right, that can share that love with the world. When I was younger, I thought that sounds corny.
Yeah.
But that's really, I think, what's going to humanize our industry, what's going to help push our values forward. And I have to give a shout out to Julie from Skunk Magazine. She coined the term Green Renaissance a few years back. And it's simply a way to express, you know, cannabis values are oftentimes at odds with corporate values. One's sustainable, one's not. And cannabis has the potential to really change so much about how we treat each other, you know, how we live our lives, how we look at nature, how we interact with the world around us.
Right.
And I guess I'm trying to think for the time that we have right now and the direction that our conversation has been going.
Yeah.
I won't ask you what your top four priorities are.
Okay.
Is there a certain feedback or a certain question that you have for the community, or is there something that you feel still isn't addressed in San Francisco as it pertains to moving forward in a positive direction? Has the community clearly communicated to you their needs?
The community, you know, definitely has communicated things. I think I came in, my predecessor started this before me, so it's been about a year and a half or plus that this office has been open. And my predecessor, Nicole Elliott, set up an incredible office. I mean, I have to tell you, I mean, coming from government, I have a sense of kind of resources and lack thereof and what that looks like. And given all that, no, of course, we can always enjoy more resources. There isn't a government agency in the world that couldn't. But I came into a space and a situation with not only what felt like, you know, a strong, solid foundation, but individuals in it who want to be there because they believe in exactly what you just said. They believe in this plant, and they believe in it for whatever different reason. And we're a very diverse office, which I really, really appreciate. And everyone's in there for a genuine purpose, right? And kind of coming back to that San Francisco thing. This is cannabis in SF. This is what it's going to feel like, and that office feels like that. And so I come in there, and I'm like, wow, this is outstanding. I feel really privileged in this space. And what I have noticed right off the bat is how responsive they are to the community. And I come from community. That was the space that I was in, and I've really been just proud of that, that we can be responsive, and that if anything, our doors are open. We're all kind of, you know, moving forward in this space without super certainty. I mean, there's a lot of moving parts. We're kind of building the plane, obviously, you know, building the plane while we're flying it, so to speak, and taking off the wings and putting them back on and doing the whole thing. We're all in this sort of together. If we can at least be open and available to the community, that's huge. Because there's so many people in other jurisdictions and other places that call their office if they even have one, and maybe the phone rings and rings and rings and it sends you to something else. And we're humans, we're people, and we want to help. And we want to further the city's mission, especially around equity. Now, that said, I come in from the DA's office, right? That's crazy. Let's be real, right?
Reprogramming time.
It's just crazy. And programming, all of it. Like, what I noticed is I'm coming in as who I am. I'm not a cannabis somm, right? They didn't hire me to be one. They hired me to, you know, for the regulation portion. But But what's more than that is that I actually get to be me. The community has said, no, Marisa, we're in. Let's do this. If you're doing this, I've just felt completely welcomed. And so I'm in. I'm all in. And who I am. And I've been accepted. So for me, that has been the most genuine, most amazing part of this process. I am hearing, I'm meeting with as many people as I can, sort of listening tour, so to speak, like trying to get out to as many people as I can. If I could only have more time in the day, because I also have to do the work, you know, and we've got to get these applications through. And I mean, as far as one priority, it's getting these permits processed. That's number one. We got to get people in their businesses doing their thing. But it's really important to get out there and feeling the love that I'm feeling from the community. And I know that every day is not going to be sunshine and rainbows. This is hard work. We're going to get this done, and we're not always going to see eye to eye. I'm not afraid of that. I come from an environment where there are tough questions and tough issues, you know, civil liberties, people's lives, you know, this thing we call the criminal justice system and all its imperfections, and being like face to face with these tough issues. I'm ready to have those conversations. I've almost been in training all this time to come into this and be like, let's go, right? And I'm excited. And some people are going to like what I have to say and some aren't, but that's okay. You know, ultimately, this is going to be the voice of the people.
If I say that you're enjoying this experience because mm-hmm. it's more humanizing than being a prosecutor, would that be correct?
No. It was humanizing to be a prosecutor.
Oh, it was humanizing.
It was, gotcha. Yeah, okay. It was. At least being one here in San Francisco. It's different. Mm-hmm. I'll say that. I'll qualify that. Definitely okay. Different. Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And if I ask you if you have an idea or a vision or a picture of San Francisco cannabis culture down the road, would you have an answer to that?
I see it growing, evolving. I think that we're a strong community, at least that's what I'm seeing so far. And I really hope that we can take this culture and dig roots, deep ones, and let them really set without too many outside pressures, right? I want to see it dig its roots. And if the community wants to fight with me to do that, I'm down to do that too. So I'm hopeful that it looks and feels and smells like SF wants it to. Mm-hmm.
I just want to say thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak with you.
Yeah, you're the first one.
That's awesome. That's awesome. We're working on building our visibility. Again, we're highlighting authentic cannabis culture, casting a positive light on the men and women in this industry, heritage operators.
Cool.
And I'm really grateful for the energy that you're bringing to San Francisco.
Thank you.
You're in great hands. Terrence Allen, Luke Gruner, Nina, everybody here. They are really, truly passionate about cannabis and the whole compassion. And San Francisco has such a rich history with
sure
cannabis.
Sure does.
And so thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any way that the audience or a viewer may get a hold of you or the office?
Absolutely. Just come to the office.
Office of Cannabis?
Come. We're right there. Come. 1 to 5 is our office hours. We're there every single day.
Is there
or
a website?
Not Saturday, Sunday. Just Google us.
Google.
San Francisco Office of Cannabis. Yeah. We're there. Come visit us. And yeah, I'm an unlikely person, an unlikely newbie. But I'm excited and I'm happy to be here, and I'm super appreciative of the community here embracing me. Because I know there was, you know, there's questions and a little anxiety from both ends. Like,
background
what's
going to
happen? Background, yeah, the whole thing. Like, what are they doing? Why are they bringing in a prosecutor? I think it makes a lot of sense in the long run. And I'm a unique prosecutor, mm-hmm. so to speak. So tomorrow at 8:30, I'm bringing the team into San Quentin. So we're going to meet some friends I've made along the way and talk about the impact of the war on drugs. And actually, I'm also bringing in the chief of police from San Francisco, and he'll be the first chief to go in and talk about kind of how to heal from the inside out. So hopefully we can have a positive conversation.
Just real quick, a question that came to mind. Are prisoners that are in San Quentin or in prison in California, now that cannabis is legal, what is the timeline for them to get out?
Oh, they're probably pretty few that are in for cannabis alone related convictions.
That's
I
a good
think
point.
That if anyone's still in for something long term, there's probably more involved.
Yeah. I
see. In California, we're at least, and especially Northern California, especially San Francisco. Like I said, our office, you know, George Gascon was the first person to say, "Hey, let's not only expunge, let's do it. Let's retroactively do this, and let's just do it. We're not going to make you petition to the court. We're not going to do all this stuff. Let's just do, and let's make that the model across the country."
Is there anything that you can share with our district attorney about mass expungement?
Yeah, do it. Uh-huh. Yeah, call the San Francisco District Attorney's Office. I used to be the person that would take those calls. we have a program, we have a process, do it. It makes the most sense, it's the right thing to do, and it's being on the right side of history. So who doesn't want to do that?
Awesome. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm extremely
my pleasure.
Grateful.
Yeah, thank you for talking to me.
Well, let's get high. Let's get high. Come on, let's get high. Let's get high. All my ladies, let's get high. High. Let's get high.